what the REST API is. WordPress, it's a software that, you know, actually powers the website. It's when you go online, when you log in WP admin, that's WordPress. Everything is generated using WordPress, filters, hooks, all of those things. That's what we actually use to publish our content, right? Now, REST API. An API, in this context, just means the rules and the protocols that we use for different pieces of software to communicate. Any digital interaction that takes place is made possible through APIs, usually. In this case, it's a RESTful API, which is kind of a computer science-y term about the specific type of API that it is. It's just one of the many architectures that an API can be set up with. Altogether, the WordPress API, I think the plugin describes it the best way, which is this plugin provides an easy use for the WordPress REST API, and grab your site's data in simple JSON format, including users, posts, taxonomies, and more. So almost anything you can do with the REST API as well as the WordPress. So just as a quick example, this is the Bluehost blog, right? It's up right now. You can look at it. It's got some blog posts and things. So if I go to bluehost.com/blog, this is what I'm going to see, right? Now, but if instead I click over to the SEO category, I'm going to see all the pages with this. Now, this is just what happens in a browser, right? So this is what I see. Okay, well, if I was going to do the same thing with the REST API, it would look more like this. The URL instead includes WP.json, WP version 2, and then the rest of the URI specifies that I want posts and categories. In this case, the SEO category happens to be category number 10, and it returns a lot more information than this, but it returns the information in a format that's more easily digestible by other devices and other apps. So usually, in terms of the REST API, it's not the end of what's happening, it's usually the first half, right? So anytime you're interacting with the REST API, usually it's the first half and then there's gonna be another piece, be that a client, an app, something else is going to be digesting this. It's not the end all. But this is what kind of what the data looks like. And if nobody's ever tried it before, just go to that URL. Just go to your website. If you've got a WordPress website, you can try it right now if you want. And just add WP.json to the end of the URL on your website. And you can see your browser will do a GET request, and it will come back. And you'll see all of the endpoints that are available there. So, starting in with posts, this endpoint here is just going to list of your posts, right? So that's going to come back with the meta about your posts, some of the content of them. If I want to see specifically post number 7, right, post ID, every post has an ID, right? So post ID number 7, I can do that. I can limit the number of results that come back, like, oh, well, if you were going to build out a widget that, oh, I just want the 3 most recent posts, I can say per page equals 3, right? Or I can limit to a specific category number. Everyone would have at least 1, which is the uncategorized category. So, and that's just posts. There's a lot of different things you can interact with. Just about anything that you can do with WordPress, you can interact that same way through this API. So everything from posts, revisions, categories, tags, this list goes on and on. And each one of these endpoints has queries that you can add to it to change, manipulate, and filter the data. So if you want something specific. And the other thing that's interesting is the information goes 2 directions as well. So it's not just GET requests, you can also update things, right? Some things would require authentication, but if I wanted to update a user, right, I could send a post request to the user endpoint and specify which user, specify what I want to update, specify the new information. All right. So the API exposes a simple yet powerful interface to WP Query, the Post API, and many more. Chances are, if you can do it with WordPress, you can do it with the API. So, now that we know what the API is, everyone's on the same page, cool things that you can do with it. And before we start in with them too, I want to point out that these are all real-world examples. A lot of times when we're talking about like Internet of Things and some of these emerging technologies that exist, there's a lot of speculative information and you'll see a lot of, I don't want to call it clickbait, but you'll see a lot of articles that are, hey, here are the things that might come out of the Internet of Things, here are the things that might come out of AI or some of these things. Okay, so today we're only going to be talking about examples that currently right now exist in the real world. So 100% future predicting accuracy, because these things already exist, we already know they're here, right? So we'll start out with Wired.com. They're doing some interesting things. For one, they're sending the info out, right? So things like Apple News, which is an app that's built in JavaScript, they're sharing the information from Wired.com to Apple News, right? And anyone can actually do that, who gets approved through a plugin. And what the plugin will actually do is it will extend the WordPress API such that the endpoints that are expected by Apple News will exist, and it's formatted in just the right way, right? So anyone can do that with this plugin. You have to go through an approval process and everything like that, but that's one of the ways they're doing this. Another thing that's kind of interesting that I found is, not that I would recommend using ad blockers, but if you do, if you block some of the ads on their page, they will actually replace those ads with more content from their site, right? If the ads don't load for whatever reason, they will be replaced with more Wired.com articles. Those articles are pulled in using JavaScript applets that are using the REST API. So that it's a really interesting fallback where it says, hey, try to load these ads, and if it can't load, fall back to this information. Right? So it's a really useful way that you could say something, and you could do this to your own site. Right? If it was built into your theme, you could say, hey, try to load this. If it doesn't load, make a little widget that pulls the latest three categories from in the news, or whatever it is, the latest three posts from this category, or this tag, or whatever it is that you're trying to do. So, another fun one is the New York Times. They had about, at a certain point, when they started, they're one of the early adopters of WordPress, at least at scale. At different points in time, they've had 80 different blogs on their namespace, and it's kind of interesting too, because they were one of the first people to be using WordPress as kind of an application layer for multiple things that were not a traditional, LAMP stack install. So one of the things that they did is, in preparation for the 2014 midterm elections, they had things called live blogs. They still do this, right? But getting ready for this, they found that a lot of people, especially with elections and stuff, they want up-to-the-minute results. They want to know how things are happening, because 10 minutes from now there could be some scandal that totally changes things, or whatever. So people are constantly refreshing, people are constantly looking. They wanted to build something out where you could just stay on the page, you could just leave it up all day, right? And the ad would cycle through, whatever they're doing would cycle through, but as new content would come in, it would automatically be added to the page, right? So that started using a version of the REST API. It's not exactly the same thing that's built into core now, but it used a version of, kind of a rudimentary version of the WordPress REST API to pull in that content. So that as new stuff came out, it would just appear on the page. And that's when they started doing things like their first draft blogs and their other live blogs for this, in preparation for this, were made possible because of this technology. So there's a really cool WordCamp talk on WordPress.tv. If you just search for New York Times, you'll find it. Where they talk about all of the different ways that they've used not just the REST API, but kind of the history of how the New York Times has, through a very complicated code base, evolved to use WordPress in kind of clever ways. It's worth checking out. Another kind of interesting one that I found is a StoryCorps mobile app. So this is a website where anyone can share their stories online. But they needed something where the editing experience would be really easy they wanted a secure way to deliver content to different areas of the web page without having to access IP addresses that weren't whitelisted. And so this actually uses the REST API to populate the content on their website with a theme that doesn't load in the traditional way. The normal way, that WordPress works in serving front-end content is stuff is built on the back end, and then PHP parses things and then outputs HTML, right, and then HTML is shown in your browser. Right, and WordPress does that from start to finish. Right, there's some sort of web browser, or web server rather, that runs the PHP and then everything all the way through until the requests that are on your browser. Right, another different approach that you can take using the REST API is to have a native JavaScript app that uses these endpoints that are delivering just the REST API stuff. Right, so you're returning back just the information about what's on the page, just the meta, those things, and the app builds the page client-side using those endpoints in JavaScript. Right, that's only possible because of the REST API. MEND, Muslim Engagement Development, is a nonprofit organization. They wanted an iOS app that would allow different users to comment, and they had all kinds of different requirements for this project. It was actually a really interesting one because they needed something where the app would be able to look at where they were and pull in content based on that. And so what they did is all of their analytics and all of the location data is done on the app itself. And then based on that, the app then queries WordPress and says, hey, show me stuff that's relevant to somebody from here, right? And so WordPress itself has no knowledge of where the user is, right? The app figures that out. And then the app is able to query WordPress. WordPress returns whatever information is needed. And then all of this is made possible because of those two separated layers. So, and which, by the way, if there was a question I actually got asked earlier, by one of the attendees about this, saying how could we integrate something like Google Analytics or whatever that, or something like that, some sort of tracking in place. Usually anything like that is going to be on the client side of things, right? Because whenever you're using the REST API, there has to be at least the two layers, right? There's the client side of things that's actually building the content, using the content in some way, and then there's the REST API side, which is saying what the content is, what the words are, the meta, the order of things like that. So whenever you've got analytics or anything like that that needs to be specific to a session, that is going to be probably done on the client side. So as they're looking at all of these, a question that is often asked, especially by people not at WordCamps, is why the heck would you use WordPress in these scenarios, right? When there's tons of app builders out there, there's tons of things that you can do. There's a tons of CMSs, in fact, that already interact really well with things like Node and other libraries that exist. Why WordPress, of all things? So there's a lot of answers